Java virtual machine. And basically, let me explain it. This is one important thing which you need to know. If you open JDK folder, let me open the JDK folder. It is available over here. Yesterday I have shown program files Java. You can see JDK folder. Okay, I'll get into any one of the JDK folder under this bin folder, where all your binary files, I mean exe files, will be available under this particular bin. Let me get into this. See, you can see so many types of exe files. In some or the other scenarios, this particular exe files will be used, either directly or indirectly. That is a different concept. Highly used and directly used files in our command prompt, otherwise Eclipse, are three different files. What are those three different files means? First one, applet viewer. Under JDK, we have applet viewer dot exe and java dot exe, java c dot exe. These are the three different files which will be available, which will be used directly. Most of the other files also will be there. Ignore that particular files. We will not be using directly. Okay. Now, under Java, we have two different types of programs. One is console-based program. Another one is window-based programs. Window-based programs in the sense, take an example of calculator, take an example of any games whichever Windows is supporting, right? In Windows you will be having games, right? This kind of games, even Eclipse tool, it is developed based on window-based programs only. Where for developing that particular types of applications, we will be using window-based programs. And directly, if you need to render the output, just now when we have seen some black screen, there we will execute the program and the output will be rendered there. More about that particular examples we will be seeing in further classes. Whereas, two different types of programs are there. I am concentrating completely on core Java. When it comes to advanced Java, that is web-based program, that is different concept. We don't want to consider that. Don't involve that concept over here. Okay. Now, for compilation of console-based program, we will use Java C. Java C stands for Java Compiler. Okay. What is the name of Java Compiler? It is JIT. Just in time. This is a compiler which will be used for compiling your Java programs. Next, for interpretation, we will use Java. This is your interpreter for interpreting console-based programs. This is your JVM. Whereas these two types of exe files, I mean javac.exe and java.exe, these two exe files we will be using for compiling and interpreting our console-based program. Whereas, what is meant by compilation? Converting. Compilation is a process of converting whole program. From higher level language to lower level language, I mean machine level bytecode format. Whole program, it will get converted at a time. when it comes to interpreter, line by line at a time. Higher level language to lower level language, line by line at a time. Okay. So, just for converting and making our machine to understand, we will make use of this particular compiler as well as interpreter. When it comes to window-based program, here same will be repeated with respect to Java C. We'll use Java C for compiling our window-based program, but for interpreting, we will use Applet Viewer. We will not be using Java, we will be using Applet Viewer for interpreting our window-based programs. So, these three files are very important. Java C, both the places it will be useful. Java and console based program, Applet Viewer and window based program. Next, window based program, that we will be covering almost at the end stage of our core Java. Whereas that is one huge topic at the end stage we will be covering. From now onwards, what we will be dealing is console based program till we reach applets. Okay. Now, already I said whole program, that is compiler, line by line, that is interpreter. Now, my question is, which is best? Which is best performer? This is one of the important interview question which they will be asking. Which is the best among compiler and interpreter? Most of the people, they will say it as compiler, but it is interpreter. Because taking whole program and digesting the whole program and rendering the output takes more time. I'm taking whole program, which is not proper. It is not good for health also to say. When it comes to interpreter, line by line, it will be very faster. Take it converted. So, interpreter performance will be higher compared to compilation. Whereas, Java will give the priority for interpretation. It will not give priority for compilation. This is one important thing which you need to know. Java is an interpreter programming language. Okay. Now, here if you observe, I said about the word JVM. Java is interpreter programming language and I am concentrating more on the JVM. Most of the people, they will be asking about JVM architecture in interviews, as well as it has go for OCJP certifications or any exams. The architecture, in the sense JVM architecture only, they will be concentrating. Now, what is JVM? We got to know how that JVM will be divided, what are the concepts will be available, we are going to see now. Okay. Now, first of all, what is meant by JVM? It is a software implementation of physical machine. Major intention of this particular JVM is, you write a program, Java program, we will be writing Java program. Once if you compile or interpret, as per JVM comes to say, if you interpret, automatically it generates a class file. It generates a class file. How many class files will be generated, based on what it will generate, that we will be seeing practically. Whereas, for every Java file, one class file will be generated. That class file will be following the concept of ORA. ORA in the sense write once, run anywhere. That means you write the program in one machine, same program, you just place it in 100 types of machines. If you have found, run it, it will run and renders the output for you. That is what the speciality of JVM compilation, I mean JVM interpretation. Now, how this particular JVM allocates the memory for the components available in your program, how many partitions it is there, we are going to see in the form of a diagram right now. This is the diagrammatic representation of your JVM architecture. You can see, don't consider about your Java file. Java file is over. We have developed, we have compiled. Now concentrate only on class file. This particular class file, see, it will be divided into three different partitions. These two partitions, you just consider it as less important partitions. These three are the major important partitions which we need to be considered. One is class loader subsystem. Another one is runtime data areas. Another one is execution machine. Class loader subsystem, it is meant majorly for verifying the classes and loading the respective classes and to check whether that extensions, everything is proper and the memory is allocated, whether the variables are initialized. These kind of things will be handled by class loader subsystem. Class loader subsystem will be meant for loading the classes, class files, and for verifying whether the class files are proper or not. Next, it is meant for initializing the variables, objects, whatever it is. That is what the major intention of class loader subsystem. Next. Okay. Now, the second partition is runtime data areas. This is one important area where the exact memory allocations happens to your program variables, methods, and during runtime you might be creating some temporary variables, threads, so many types of components we will be using during runtime of the program. For that, allocation of memory, deallocation of memory will be done by making use of this particular stack area. This is just for allocating the memory during runtime of the program. Remember this. More about this I will explain in next slides. Next, execution engine. This is meant for optimizing the code. That means reducing the code levels and compressing the code for faster migration and generating the output, for enabling the garbage collection. Garbage collection means any variables which is initialized to null and which is not in use, that particular variables will get collected. And native method interface and native method library. These are predefined interfaces, predefined libraries we will be loading over here. What is that? We will be seeing in the next slide. Yes, how does JVM works? This JVM, it will be divided, as I said, it will be divided into three different partitions: class loader subsystem, runtime data area, and execution engine. Next, class loader subsystem. This is meant for loading rt.jar. See, bootstrap class loader. First of all, what is meant by bootstrap? most of the people, whenever they hear this concept Bootstrap, they will connect to Bootstrap CSS. Okay, it is Bootstrap CSS for designing, that way they will be thinking. That is not correct. Whereas this particular Bootstrap, in the sense during booting of the program, otherwise starting time of the program, which has to be loaded, which files has to be loaded, will be considered under Bootstrap. And one important jar file, jar stands for Java Archive. If you want, just make a note. Jar stands for Java Archive. Okay, what is this Java Archive? Archive, in the sense, it is a compressed folder, like as we have RAR format, zip format. You might have seen this particular types of files in your machine. Similar to that, for compressing Java programs, in the sense, in one particular folder we will be writing Java programs, class files, everything. Those things you will be compressing and you will be making it as one executable file, that is jar file. Okay, we have one particular jar file which is very important, that is rt.jar file. While executing the program, I'll show you, either in command prompt also it is needed, it will be available. Even in Eclipse also it is needed, it will be available. I'll show you that. Okay, this is meant for loading your class files. For that say, we'll load this rt.jar files as a highest priority one. Next, all the classes loading will be done by making use of gre lib. Okay, whatever the classes we are loading, everything will be loaded by making use of gre lib. Gre folder is there and lib folder is there. Under this lib folder, we will be having class files. Everything will get loaded into that particular thing. Extension class loader. Next, application class loader. This will be holding the complete information about the class path, the path you have set, and the environment variables. If it is not loading properly, this could be one of the reasons. Otherwise, operating system will be another reason. Next, delegation hierarchy algorithm. Basically, to delegate the program to next level, to generate the output, will make use of delegation hierarchy algorithm. Next thing is linking. This is under first module only. Whereas linking, in the sense, we need to verify whether the code is correct or not, it is error free or not, we need to check. Prepare in the sense, some variables will not be initializing. That particular variables, if it has to be initialized with some default values, otherwise default parameters needs to be analyzed, then we'll make use of prepare. Resolve, which means whatever the memory references has to be allocated, if that variable is referring to some other memory, some other variable, for either for storing the data, fetching the data, complete allocation and resolution will happen under resolve. Next, initialization. All the stack variables, that means we will be having static variables, original variables, like this, different types of variables will be available. That particular thing, how we can initialize, where we can store that particular things, will be done by initialization. Whereas more about this, I'll explain in further classes. Runtime data area. As I said, we will be having method area for storing static variables, and method information will be there under that. Heap area, whatever the variables what we are creating, the memory allocation like arrays, variables, everything will be under heap area. When it comes to stack area, you can see all the local variables, next local variable array, operand stacks, frame data, that means huge set of data, exceptions, whatever we have got, everything will be available over there. Next, PC register, it will be holding the information about the program, whichever the program it is pointing, which program is active right now, that complete information will be available under PC register. Next, native method stacks. Whenever if I say native, that is predefined methods available under your Java, JDK, whatever it is. About that particular files, whatever you have used, the information about that will be stored under native method stacks. If you are using any predefined classes, predefined variables, information about that will be stored over here. That is about runtime area. Next, execution engine. Next, execution engine. Under this particular execution engine, we will be having the information about the bytecode, whatever we are executing, and whatever we have interpreted, how much time we have taken for interpretation, the complete information will be available under this execution engine. JIT compiler information, which is the code which has been generated, code optimization means compressing the code, target code, which type of output has to be generated, profiler, it is basically for multiple times if you need to call the same method, that information will be held under profiler. Garbage collector, basically if you need to force garbage collector, you can do by making use of system.gc, otherwise runtime.gc. I'll be explaining how to do that also in upcoming programs. Whereas default garbage collector will be available, where it will collect the objects whichever is in not in use. Whatever the objects which you are not in use, that will be collected back. When it comes to Java native interface, native interface, whenever if I say native, predefined, whatever the interfaces, classes available, and the libraries available, libraries means your jar files, all those things, whichever is required for execution of your program will be available under this level. These are the things which you need to know under JVM. Now we are going to start up with first program of Java. Okay, the first program of Java we are going to start up. Whereas whenever you are developing a program, as I said already in previous session, you need to download JDK, you need to set the path, and get ready with the command prompt, everything. Once if you set the path in that particular fashion, however I said, you can run and execute the program wherever you want in your machine. Okay, whereas my first program which I am going to show you is this particular program. You can see this is helloworld.java, public class hello world, public static void main, string args, system.out.println, hello world. Simple. To see and to say, it is very simple. It will generate the output, hello world. Everybody will say, who knows some part of technology, they can say very easily. But what is this public? What is this class? What is this static? What is string? What is args? system, all those things we are going to see in this particular session. Okay, now let me type that particular program over here. Okay. Now, what you will be observing over here in this particular program, if you check it out properly, okay, this is the program. If you want, I'll share this program also. Now, let me make one folder. Okay, I want to store it there. You can see, I'll go to this PC, E drive, for Java examples. Here, see, one important thing which you need to consider here, your class name is Hello World and it is using the access specifier public. So whenever any class is using the access specifier public, make sure that you are saving the program with that particular name only. I mean HelloWorld.java. Why? I'll tell you the reason. Okay, see, here I'm giving double quotes because sometimes it will take .txt as extra extension. To avoid that, I'll give it in double quote so that it will get saved exactly in Java format. You can see HelloWorld.java I have created now. It is Java file, size is this much. So we got to know how to save the file, right? That's done. Now, what we need to know about this program? Saving public static void, I'll tell you later. Wait for a few minutes, I'll tell you. Before getting into that, one important thing which you need to know. I hope you know C, C++, any one of the programming languages. There, printf is a function which will be used or which will be available under stdio.h. If I need to use printf, I need to include that stdio.h. I'll agree. When it comes to C++, if I need to use cin or cout, iostream.h, I have to include. We know this. This is most common term. It will be available and most of the people, they will be using it. When it comes to our particular Java program, you can see system.out.println. Who will provide this? String. Who will provide this? That is what important thing which you need to know right now. Okay? java.lang.hashtag. This is the default package of Java language. Default package. What is meant by package? As we have header files in our C C++ programming languages. In Java language, we will be having packages. Package, more about package we will be learning later. Just I am giving small information about packages. Package is a folder. Similar to our folders, how to create a folder, you know. Similar to that particular folder, even in Java programming language also, we will be creating a folder. We will be storing some predefined classes. We in the sense, not we. Java Sun Microsystem people or Oracle people who has designed this JDK, they have created one folder in JDK bin. Under that, they have stored some set of classes, interfaces, etc., etc. type of things. Where from that we will be using into our program. Whereas, okay, now you can see Java dot. That means this is the main folder which you need to know. That means under main folder Java, you will be having subfolder lang. Lang is a subfolder of Java folder. I mean package, technically to say. Under that, this hashtag symbol. Remember this point? Hashtag stands for pattern matching or while the character, we call it as. Pattern matching character, otherwise while the character, we call it as. Whereas, to import all the classes and interfaces available under lang package, we will make use of hashtag. So that whenever if you use hashtag, automatically all the classes and interfaces of lang package will be imported. That is what one important thing you need to notice over here. Everything, remember, all the classes and interfaces only, it will not include sub packages. Under that folder you can have subfolders also, that you will not get. Only files you will get, folders you will not get. Remember this. Technically what is class, what is interface, you will be learning slowly. Okay, now this particular lang package is default package. Default in the sense, either you come to class or not, it is not a matter. Defaultly I should come, because this is my duty. The same way here also, whether we are using the concepts of that particular package or not, it is not a matter. Defaultly in your Java program, that Java package will be available. Either you use it, you won't use it, but that will be there. That is what default is all about. If you are using also, not an issue. Okay. But in all the programs, I am telling you, every program we will be using some or the other concepts of lang packages. Some or the other way, we will be using lang packages. Okay. That is one important thing to be noticed over here. Next, under this particular package we have one class called as object. I hope you know about C++. With that knowledge, I am taking the advantage and I am referring the class term. Class is nothing but, if it is C++ terms, class you know, C terms, structure. I hope you know about structure. Advanced to structure, the concept is class. Where in this structure you will be having only variables. When it comes to class, you will be having variables and functions also. Okay, more about that I will be explaining in the program. Okay, whereas, as we will be having predefined functions under stdio.h like printf, scanf, etc. etc. Here, this object is a predefined class. Under this object class, we have somewhere around 8 to 9 methods are there, 9 functions are there. Either directly or indirectly, we will be using the methods of that object class. Okay? By default, object class will be available to any of the class you are using in your program. Whatever, either you create a class, you use the existing class, the methods of object class will be available. What is the use of object class? All those things I will tell you later. Whereas, right now what you need to know, this is the super class for all the classes in Java. Remember this point. This is very important interview question. Most of the people, they will be asking this one. What is object class? Can you explain the methods of object class? And which all the methods you can override? On this terms, you can expect at least one question in course Java. So, I am giving you the hint right now. It is a super class for all the classes in Java. The methods of the class we will be using. How to use, I will tell you. How to override the methods also, I'll tell you later. Okay. So, these two things, by default, it will be available in your program. Whichever the program you write, by default, it will be available. These two. Okay. Now, we'll get into our program. See, I'm using the editor, text editor, Notepad++. So, this particular editor will highlight some words, predefined words, it will highlight. Okay, whichever has been highlighted over here, you can see public class, public static, void, these are highlighted with different color. Other things are in black color and the parentheses are there in blue color, dark blue. Okay. Leave about that particular parenthesis right now. Leave about that black colored wala also. We'll go for this particular highlighted things. Public. Whichever are highlighted over here, those are called as keywords. Keywords. Keywords in the sense, these are already defined in the compiler. It has certain meaning. It has certain work to be done. What is the reason for defining that particular keyword? What is the usage of that particular keyword? Everything is predefined. You can use that particular keywords as per that particular rules and regulations. If you violate the rules, it will not work. So, remember, keywords are predefined words in your compiler, where that cannot be used for your customization purpose or for your own uses as you want. You can use it for specific reasons how it is designed. Okay. Now, first keyword which I am going to explain it is public. Basically, we have different types of access specifier, otherwise we will call it as access modifiers also. Okay, modifiers in Java. Okay, under this particular modifiers we have four different types of modifiers. One is public, one is private, next protected, next default. These are the four different types: private, protected, public. These are predefined keywords. Even default keyword is there, but that default keyword and this one not same. Remember this. If you are not specifying anything, that is default. Whereas default keyword purpose is different. For in switch case we will use default, that is different, and whatever I am referring over here is different. Okay, fine. These are predefined keywords: public, private, protected. When it comes to public, public in the sense, I hope you know public properties. Everybody can get in. Public properties, public park is there, public mall is there, public places, whichever the public places are there, everybody can get in. No need of anybody's permission over there. Got it, right? You can get in. Sometimes I just take an example of Lal Bagh, where you don't need to take anybody's permission. So if they have placed any ticket, you take the ticket and get in. Whether I have to get in or not, how much time I have to stay, this kind of where to sit, all those things you don't need to ask. Get in. Got it, right? That is public place. When it comes to private place, let's say if you come to my house, you don't know me, I don't know you. Just a casual visit you came, otherwise for some purpose you have come down. At the time you have to take my permission. Whenever you are stepping in, can I get in? Can I sit here? Can I have some water? Something. You need to take the permission. That is private property, my property. Correct, right? Public means everywhere and for everyone it is accessible. Private means only for me, because that I have designed for myself. So for me only it will be accessible, and to my family members it is accessible. Within my family, whomever are there, it will be accessible. Protected. It is in a real time scenario to say, whatever I have developed, whatever it is there with me, it will be utilized by my family and my next generations. Got it, right? In the sense, my next generations, either my kid, my grandson, granddaughter, whomever it is, my next generations, if they want to utilize my properties, they can utilize that. That is protected. That means they should be my relation. They should be having some connection with me. Whereas you cannot become my protected members, because I don't have any relation with you. That is protected. Default. Default, it is above private, less than protected. That means to certain range. More about this particular access specifies, when we are dealing with inheritance concept, I can explain more. Whereas here, to get an idea what is private, protected, public is all about, I have just given rough idea. When we are dealing with inheritance concept, we will be dealing more about this. Okay, next. Whenever, if you want any concept, concept in the sense, I am considering either it can be variable, either it can be method, either it can be class. If you want to be accessed everywhere, that means either you write your program here, otherwise somewhere, and a different set of programs are there. If they want to access your program, you need to make it public. If you make it public, then it will give you the freedom to get access wherever you want. Anybody can access your program, anybody can utilize your program. Let's take an example. I'll tell you one example. Whereas in this scenario, I'll be developing one project, some online e-commerce project. I want my customers to pay the amount through online. Credit card, debit card, PayPal, that call, this call is there right now. Whereas, if they need to do the payment, I need to have some service. That means that the credit card acceptance fields will be there, right? I think you might have seen some fields where you need to enter your credit card number, your name, expiry date, etc., etc. Details will be there. That details, if it has to be visible on your screen, and based on the details, if the amount has to be deducted from the customer and if it has to be deposited into your account, we need to utilize some payment gateway service from some banks. So that particular bank service is public. I can utilize, another company people can utilize, I will utilize it, I will pay some amount to him. So that is global. That is public. I will be utilizing whenever my customer is doing any transaction, I will pay some commission to him. Otherwise, initially I will pay some 10,000 to you. Don't ask me anything later how many other transactions happened. This type of commitments also are there. There is different concept, but to give you a simple example, I said that is public. Anybody can use it. Okay? Now, for enabling, see, they have defined it public. The reason is, most of the people, they will utilize my service and I will get money. In that way they have thought and they made it as public service. Suppose if they made it as a private service only for that particular company, who will utilize? Only company people will utilize. They will not earn so much money. Only for company purpose they will utilize. That is the matter. Now, in this program, I made it as public. That means, this program, anybody can call it without any permission. No need to take anybody's permission because it is public. And the class. See, class is also a keyword. Whereas, basically, for defining a class, okay, basically for defining a class, we'll make use of this particular class keyword. And this particular class keyword will take one value. See this, hello world. And see here, ARG. Hello world and ARG. What is the link between that in the sense? Both are identifiers. Identifiers in the sense, user specified values. Instead of hello world, I can specify my name. Instead of ERG, I can specify my native name. Like this. Whatever I want to specify, I can specify over there. That is user specified value. Identifier. Next. Some people, they will fix their mindset blindly. I have seen that website, I have seen this book. Everywhere it is ERG, ERGS only, and the braces are like this only. I will follow that one. That is stupidity. Whereas, one person might have developed based on that, and other person might have copied. Whereas, by considering that particular thing, everything should be like this only in the sense, that is stupidity. Where, I am telling you right now, these are identifiers. You can change however you want. You give your own name. You give whatever you want. No issues with that. Okay? Whereas, one thing to be followed. What is what? That one thing to be followed in the sense. There I have used hello world. Same hello world, I cannot use it here. That you remember. Don't go for same name for every place. You different name. It will work. Okay. Fine. I have defined a class over here. Public class, hello world. So my class is defined. Under this class, I can define the variables. I can define methods. I can define constructors, etc., etc. type of things. I can define. Whereas, in this program, I have defined only one main method. You can see public static void main string ar process. Okay, public, just now I said this method should be available everywhere. To make it globally visible, we are using the concept of, we are using the access specifier public. Next, static. This is one important term to be noticed. Static is a keyword basically for this particular reason. I'll tell you one example. If you need to call any variable, if you need to call any function of a class outside the class, what you have to do first? You need to create an object for the class. With that object, you will call the variable. With that object, you will call the function. Whereas, to skip that step, to skip the particular object creation step, you can make that variable or method as static. In the sense, in this scenario, main is a static. You can call that particular main function directly. You don't need to create an object for hello world. With that object, you don't need to call main function directly. If you say main, main will get called. How that static members will be used? In upcoming concepts, we have the concept called as keywords. Under that static, more explanation I will give it to you. For the time being, for making this function to be accessed without creating an object, I am defining it as static. Remember this. What about void? From this function, I mean main function, you cannot expect any return value. Nothing will be returned. Return means, I hope you know, int, float, something. Some values will be returned. Where for this main function, nothing will be returned. So that will be void only. And only these two keywords can be exchanged. Static public void main, otherwise public static void main, both are same. Okay. What about main? Entrance of your program. How many classes are there? How many methods are there? How many variables are there? All those things is bullshit. Where main is there, from that position only your program will start. From the main function onwards, your execution will start and your steps will start executing and it will call the functions, generates the output. Okay, for my program, the entrance is main, this one. Okay, here you just observe this one. This main function is taking, in C program also this concept is there, that is called as command line arguments. If a main function is taking some parameters, then that particular parameters are called as command line arguments. You just see here, we are taking string AR brackets. That means string type of arguments we are taking as a parameter. And how many we are taking, what is the type it will accept, that we will be seeing in next session. Let's start now. Whereas, so far we got to know about public, static, void and main. What is the use of that particular keywords as well as methods? Now, what is this string ARG and that particular brace? What's the meaning of that? Let me explain it to you. First thing what you have to observe over here is, already I have said that default package which will be available for your Java programs is java.lang package. From that particular lang package, we got so many classes. Under that, one class is string, another class is system. Remember this? System and string. These two are the classes from lang package. Whereas, whenever I say the term class, whenever I say the term interface, all predefined classes and interfaces, first letter will be capital. Can observe? String S capital, system S capital. All predefined classes and interfaces, first letter will be capital. When it comes to functions, it will follow different case. When I am explaining about that particular functions, I will explain which case it will follow. This is title case. Title case in the sense, first letter will be capital, rest of the characters will be small. When it comes to methods, different case, I will explain that later. Okay. Now, you can see here, string arg braces. Means, here main function is taking string arguments as parameters. String arguments in the sense, string is a class which can store any type of values. Let's say if you need to store numeric values, you can store into string object. If you need to store character type of data, you can store. You can store decimal values also into string. Like this, any type of values if you need to store, you can make use of string class. Whereas, if you go for integer, you can store only numeric without decimals. If you go for float, you can store only float with the decimals. You cannot store characters. So, by thinking in this particular way, this Java developers, that means who has designed this particular Java programming language, they have designed main function which will take string arguments as parameter, where these arguments are considered as command line arguments. The arguments taken by main method is called as command line arguments. Whereas, by making use of this command line arguments, we will take the inputs from the console. Whereas, how many inputs we can take, which type of inputs we can take, based on the user mindset, they cannot design. Let's say, I want some three inputs only. One input is of integer, one input is of float, one input is of character in the sense. They cannot change the type of inputs. The parameters they cannot change based on my requirement. One person says I want 100 parameters for him, 100 size for me, only 3 is the size. My requirement is 3 different data types. His requirement is all the 100 it should be string type only. Like this, based on the user, they cannot change the type. So, to make it generic, what they have did, they specified string. String means any type it will accept. Okay. And they have defined array of arguments. Array of arguments in the sense, here how many ever values you want to take, you can take. You can see that array also, they didn't specify any size over here. Let's say if they specify any size like 10, suppose you can allow 10 values only. Whereas another user, if he wants more than 10 in the sense, that will be tough. So only they went in this fashion. Like there is no size, so that how many ever arguments they want, let them pass. If they don't want arguments, let them don't pass. They want different types of arguments, let them pass different type. No issues. will be there with this particular string arguments. And as I said previously, here there is no rule like it should be string arg, args only. You can specify anything. Those are identifiers. Hello world and arg are identifiers. You can keep your name also over here. Okay. And one more way you can see, they will be defining the arguments in this fashion also. Even this is correct. Just I have replaced that particular brackets this side. Replace that particular brackets before that particular object. Even this is also acceptable in your command line arguments. I mean array objects declaration. This is one thing. And one more important thing is this one. This is one more way to declare command line arguments. Here I have specified string space 3 dots space arg, which means even this will be considered as command line arguments with unlimited size. Where by making use of this, you can accept any number of values and any type of values from the user. These are the three possible ways you can pass command line arguments in Kojo. Next. Now, what is this system.out.println? Now, we need to know about this particular system.out.println. Let me take a minute and draw the representation how it will be. Okay. Here I will edit slightly. Static. Even here also. Here also. Yes. Now you can see system.out.println. That is what we have seen. And this system.out.println is similar to your printf in your C programming, cout in your C++. Whereas system is a class, you can see system is a class under lang package. Under that system class, we have out object. Out is an object of printstream. And that too it is static. As it is static, directly by the use of class name system.out, I am calling this out. By making use of this out, I can call the functions of printstream. Where control will go to printstream. Printstream is a class of IO package. You can see, as system is a class of lang package, printstream is a class of IO package. More about IO package in upcoming classes you will be learning. Where under printstream, you have print function and println function and more functions are there. Where this print function, it is defined in such a way that it can take any kind of values. Let's say integer, float, string, array, any type of values it will take. Now, if I need to print just the value, system.out.print, otherwise println. Difference between print and println is, print will print the value, control will not go to next line. Whereas, println will print the value, control will be transferred to next line. That makes the difference between print and println. Now, what about this err? Under system, we have err also. Err object you can see here. Even this is an object of printstream, even though it is static, we can make use of system.err.print, otherwise println. Which case we will use out in the sense, just for printing some message, some result, we'll make use of print and println. When it comes to printing error message to the console, we will make use of system.err.print and println. Let's say you have handled some exception, if you need to display some exception to the user, we'll make use of system.err.print, otherwise println. What's the difference in the sense? Normal message will be displayed in black color, that is what the result. Based on the color, you can identify whether it is result, otherwise whether it is error message. When it comes to err, it will print the message in red color, which means it is giving you the denotation that it is an error message which occurred in your program. With that color variation only, you can identify whether it is proper message, otherwise error message. So those are the important things which you need to know at this stage under system class and printstream. So whenever if anybody asks what is system.out.println, don't say blindly that out is an object of system class, that is null. That is what the reason I have explained in this diagrammatic representation. Remember this diagrammatic representation. System is a class under lang package, out is an object of printstream. With that object we are calling println, where we are passing string object as parameter to print it on the console. So it generates hello world as a result to you on the console. Now let me show you how to run this particular program. Now one thing you have to remember over here, in this program the main method is there in this program only, and that too one class only is available. First thing is, in the same class we have main method, and that too one class only is available, as well as that particular class is public. You can see public, main is there here only, and that too one class only is there. So by considering all these reasons, as the class is public, you need to save the file name also with that particular class name only, helloworld.java. I have did that, already I have shown how to save it also. Now let's compile this. Already I have shown you how to install, how to set the path also for your JDK. Now let me compile this. Okay, first my programs are available in this location. So let me go to command prompt. And to this location, I'll step in. Okay. Right now, I'm there in that particular location. Now, I will type Java C to check whether the path is set or not. Yes. If it is showing this kind of options, all those things, path is set properly. Already can check out my previous video also, whereas how to set the path, everything I have recorded over there. Okay. Next. Now my file name is helloworld.java. You can observe only Java file is there over here. Now I'll compile this Java C helloworld.java and save. There is no errors. If errors are there, it will be showing the errors here itself. Simply, it has executed that and it came to next level. You can see a class file generated over here. What is the name of the class file? Hello World only. Now, Java Hello World. We have to apply. It generates the result, hello world. That is what the thing what I have written in the program. And one more thing to be remembered over here. If I do any small change, let's say, now if I do any small change, again I have to compile the code. Again I have to do Java C. If I'm not compiling the code, it will take previous class file result only into consideration. Let me show you, hello world only it is displayed. If I compile it again, new class file will be generated, I mean it will overwrite the class file whatever is there and generates the proper result. This is a way to execute the program in command prompt. Okay, and one more thing I'll show you over here. Some people will feel tough to go to command prompt, execute the program through command prompt. Where for them, I'm going to show you the best solution how to create a batch file. Simple. Whatever the commands I have typed in the command prompt, you type it over here. Java C hello world dot Java. Okay, next Java hello world. Next, one more extra command you need to type over here is pass. In the sense it will be waiting to show you the result. Let me save this. Save as any name dot bat. Bat means batch file. You can see, and this is applicable for Windows operating system. I'm saying it's not for any other operating system. You can see batch file is generated. If you want, you can right click edit. If you want, you can change the code over here. Any steps you have to change. Okay, this batch file, it is simple executable file. On click, it opens the command prompt, it executes the statements, generates the output. It is waiting for your key input. If I press any key, automatically it will get closed. This is the way to generate and use batch file in your Java program. That is what the first program is all about. How to run the first program, everything we have seen in this particular session.